Dr. Varun Ramurthy is HOD Department of Critical Care, Pelamal Medical College, Madurai. He is a qualified anesthetist. He holds European Diploma in Intensive Care. Earlier, he has worked in many hospitals as critical care specialist, including Mayotte Hospital a few years ago. He is a financial planner for the last 8 years. He is a certified financial consultant for the last 4 years. He has a unique distinction of hat trick in $1 million roundtable membership. And that is a unique club of investors and people who get insurance beyond a particular amount. And he's one of the top 5 MDRT in India. Welcome, Varun.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Vimal Raj Valayagam is well known to this crowd. He is a HPP and a liver transplant surgeon in my hospital. He is a surgical gastroenterologist by training. He has had his HPP and liver transplantation training at Seoul. He also underwent a laparoscopic HPP fellowship in Paris. He self-acquired knowledge in financial matters, apparently has been due to hits and misses in investing, and I presume he has burnt his fingers, and with that, he has become more knowledgeable. Welcome, Vimal.
Thank you, sir.
The first step in financial management, I presume, is to ensure that you and your dependents are not left in dire straits when you suddenly become ill or not around. So then there is also a possibility of professional catastrophe, which can bring in enormous amount of financial strain on the surgeons. To introduce the basics of insurance, I now request Dr. Kumaresh to give his presentation. Dr. Kumaresh.
Thank you, but sir, at the outset, I thank everyone for giving me this opportunity. I will start my presentation.
You'll have to talk a little louder, Dr. Kumaresh.
Okay, sir. Now, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. With regard to wealth, there are two risks in life. Risk of living too long is also a risk, because there is a possibility of outliving our money. So we should plan for retirement pension planning. And risk of living too
short. Your image has not come. Dr. Kumaresh, your presentation is not on the screen.
Okay, sir.
It's coming in.
Okay, you can start talking and hopefully it will come.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Risk of living too short is also risk. For that, we have got a wonderful tool known as life insurance. Because if we some catastrophic event occurs, then we leave our dependent kids and spouse behind. For that risk of living too short, we have got a wonderful tool that is known as life insurance. Who needs life insurance? Suppose just now I have finished my PG and starting my career, I don't have any education loan and my parents doesn't depend on me. At that time, there is no need for any life insurance at all because there is no financial dependent. Just now, I'm coming to a second scenario. Just now I got married. I got married to a working wife or professional wife, spouse. Then at that time also, there is no financial dependence. But the insurance advisors generally advise, sir, you are got married, then you have to take life insurance, all those things. But at that time also, at this time, there is no financial dependence. So there is no need for any life insurance at all. But once a kid is born, a financial dependence is developed, at that time, definitely we should take a life insurance. Then the second question comes, how long needed? Because there are so many companies have come out with 100 years plan, 28 till age of 85. So how long it is needed? That we have to do. For example, till there is financial dependence, how long we need life insurance means, suppose I am 45 year old, I have got 11 year old boy and 6 year old kid. Till how long life insurance needed means, till there is financial dependence. My son, if I get 20 years life insurance, that is more than enough. because my son will be, after 20 years, he will be 31. His education and marriage might have completed. And for my daughters also, education and marriage might have completed. So how long needed means till there is financial dependence. How much sum assured needed? For that, we have to do a small calculation known as human life value. Suppose I'm earning 10 lakhs per annum and my financial dependence is there for next 20 years means I need, my human life value is 200 lakhs or 2 crores. It's a simple calculation because at present my earning is 10 lakh per annum. If I live for next 20 years, then I need to take a life insurance for 2 crores. That's my human life value today. So I should need to take life insurance for 2 crores. Then next wealth destroyer is mainly our health. So what I suggest is minimum we have to take Mediclaim policy for 10 lakhs. The life insurance should be taken only for breadwinners or earning members of the family. We should not take life insurance in kids' name because we should not be emotional on insurance and investments because kids are not breadwinners or earners. The life insurance should be taken only in the name of breadwinners or earning members. But Mediclaim policy should be taken for all the family members. If anyone of the family member becomes sick, then the family's wealth is destroyed. So minimum 10 lakhs, we should take Mediclaim policy. The next is professional indemnity policy. This is my Mediclaim policy. See, it should be taken for all of the whole family members. How much sum should I have taken? I have taken for 50 lakh rupees. So 30 lakh rupees, no claim bonus is there. Total sum assured, I got 80 lakh rupees. This much sum assured we needed. What I suggest is only 10 lakh or 25 lakh as a family floater. But I have taken 80 lakhs. This much sum assured we need? Yes. In Corona, this New Hope Hospital owner, doctor has got bill came out to be 98 lakhs. 98 lakhs, the bill came out. But I have taken not because of Corona, it has taken long back. Mainly, I took this policy because of only one condition, that is road traffic accident. If four of our family members going in a car met with the accident, then the hospital bill will be around 20 lakhs each and every person. So totally 80 lakhs will be there. Whether 80 lakhs will be there in our bank account? Generally not. So this will be taken care of. So how much premium that I am paying? 36,000 per annum. 36,000 per annum. Only 3,000 rupees per month. This will give peace of mind. If you take small policy, big premium will be there. If you take big policy, premium will be very small. Next, because of my profession, this is possible. Professional indemnity. Apart from PPLS of IMA Tamil Nadu, I have taken for 25 lakhs. What is the premium? 1,200 rupees. Only 100 rupees per month. So this is for wealth protection. Life insurance for earning members. Mediclaim policy, family floater for all the family members. Minimum 10 to 25 lakhs. And professional indemnity policy. Thank you, sir.
Now thank you. Varun, I may ask you about the health insurance. You know, if you have parents at home around 60 or above, and you are the main earning member of the house, should you take policy separately for yourself and your parents, or you should take it as a family floater? And there are many issues about health insurance, previous illness, pre-existing illnesses, critical illness. Can you just throw some light on that?
Yes, sir. Actually, as Sir Kumarishwar has given in the few slides, what he has taken for his family, it's very good because he has taken a floater for two adults and two kids. But when it comes to elder people, as you said, so there will be pre-existing illness. Most of the insurance policies, companies, health insurance companies, they ask you to wait for 2 years or any pre-existing illness. So, and it is not ideal to add a 75-year-old to your family floater, because it's going to increase your total premium for the whole family. So the thing is that you should start early. If you're not started early, there are two other options. Many hospitals right now have something called as group insurance, wherein if you pay 10,000 rupees, for example, in Kovai Medical Center in Coimbatore, they have a 9,000, 10,000 rupees group insurance. Your family members are covered for 10 lakhs. So any up to 10 lakhs, anything happens, for the one person, you have to pay 10,000. That is the cheapest. Does not come with any question of pre-existing illness. So if your company, if your hospital does not have any of this group insurance, you need to go for a separate insurance for the breadwinners, I mean, for the elderly people. Right now, I think, for example, Star gives you 75 years plus red carpet plans. So from the day zero, they take it. But the premium for 1 crore comes to anywhere between 64,000 to 70,000 for a single person. And for 25, I think for 25 lakhs, it comes to around 60,000 per person, because they are liable to get into diseases and get into critical illness and stuff. So health insurance, when it comes for elderly people with pre-existing illness, it's really tricky.
Thank you. Arun, that means you say if you have family, sir, one person is elder, so obviously his age is going to determine the total premium. So yes, if you recommend that only that person is paid separately for a premium if required.
Yes, sir. Better if they have two, like for example, our father-in-law and his wife, both are elderly, better to go for a separate premium for them. Have a family floater for yourself and then have a separate premium for them.
So another issue is, supposing I have a premium for 5 lakhs and I think this 5 lakhs is inadequate.
You're talking of, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
10 lakhs, the additional 5, I put it as what? I buy another one or raise the 5 to 10 or I do what is called top up.
Yes, sir. If you are having, if you are in with an insurance company like a Star Health Insurance, for example, but you want to raise your premium because of this ongoing corona illness, it's better to stick to the same premium company and raise your premium. There are many options to increase your premium in that company. That is, the family floaters from 25 lakhs, you can increase to 50 to 75 lakhs. That is accept, because already all these elderly people are already covered. So the pre-existing illnesses will be added onto it. So it will be ideal to increase your top up in the same insurance company. There are options available for that, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you. And for professional indemnity, what should be the nominal value for a surgeon, let's say, irrespective of the specialty? Plastic surgeon, I believe they are at a high risk.
So I think a lot of surgeons here, sir said for an anesthetist, 25 lakhs supposed to be good. But if you're going for transplant anesthesia, sir's field is in renal transplant, I would recommend at least minimum 50 lakhs. Because even the surgery cost is anywhere between 35 to 45 lakhs. So for liver transplant and stuff. So it is better to go for 50 lakhs. For surgeons, minimum, I would recommend 50 lakhs. But I would also recommend, if you're taking from new group insurance, there are a lot of companies giving professional indemnity. Take also from PPLSS, have IMA by your side. Because the IMA covers you only for 5 to 10 lakhs or 25 lakhs. But it is not the amount. They have a well-oiled system. They have a good network of people who will deal with out-of-court settlements and everything. So it is better to have a professional indemnity from PPLSS. But for unforeseen circumstances, you need to go for other group insurances. Many group insurances, you have to make sure that it will cover the cost of the ongoing custody. I mean, any court cases and everything. Many of the indemnity policies, once you are awarded this whatever be the amount, they are ready to pay it. But nobody takes care of the court cases, the ongoing litigation charges and stuff. So I think we should go for that too.
Thank you. There is somebody who has raised a question, Dr. Yes. Prabhu. He says, why should you have a life insurance for 2 crores? Isn't it very expensive?
I think, yes, sir. I think Kumaresha made the point. The idea is, it is called productivity. For example, sir, if you're earning 10 lakhs per year, as sir said, I'll give you go with the same example. Your family is dependent on you if some catastrophe happens, your family is going to miss you for the next 10 years. That is a basic idea. So whatever is your income at this point, whatever is the productivity at this point, this year, the next 10 years, the family will miss your productivity. For example, you'll have some commitments. Those will be for the next 10 years. Then the family, your wife or your kids, they will stand on themselves in the next 10 years. So your income will be missed for the next 10 years. So your productivity is something, your per annum income into 10 times. And that is the amount, that's the highest amount any insurance company can give you. Though you have taken 5 crores with SBI, 5 crores with HDFC, 10 crores with many other things, they will give you, based upon your IT returns, only 10 times is the cap amount they will give you, combined from all insurance companies.
Okay, Varun, one more question. What if the wife is also an earning member? Then yes, her dependency on you is much less. So she can take care of the financial thing to a large extent. In which case, can this total amount be reduced, or it should be a one for the wife, one for the husband?
It's a very nice question, sir. Thing is that, sir, as I don't know from others, but my wife's income never comes to me. It stays in her account.
Oh,
I think most of us will agree.
That is the truth with everybody.
Exactly, sir. Exactly. So, if whatever you are considered as a breadwinner, even your wife might be earning more than you, doesn't matter. You are considered the breadwinner. You are supposed to pay the EMIs. You are supposed to be the banker. You are supposed to be the accountant and everything. So, I think all the commitments will be based on our income, sir. So, even the wife is an earner, very good, very well and good, but you do this for reducing her burdens. They should not miss you financially, because if I am correct, if both are earners, the commitments are also double. You go easily into a 4 crore apartment flat you buy because both of us are earning. So you invest in your kids' education in a bit luxurious medical seat or something like that. So I think with both earners, our commitment also goes up. So I think we should go for a complete plan, and we should not take any risk in that. And as Sir said, if you take, for example, I took my life insurance for 2 crores at the age of 28, it cost me 12,000 rupees. If somebody takes the same 2 crores at 40 years, if I take this insurance policy fresh at this age, I'll have to shell out anywhere between 60 to 80,000. So if you start early, the 2 crores, you are going to give 12,000 per year, it's not going to work. It's not going to matter at all. So better you plan for the productivity that you're going to attain in the next 10 years, not what you are having at this point. I'm just finished PG. I'm just going for a 75,000 salary. Doesn't mean that I should take a lesser policy. Never go less than 1 crore or 2 crores.
Thank you, Arun. Thanks for clarifying issues. First step is insurance. The second step is whatever money you earn will have to remain safe and possibly grow and be available to you when you need it. So to talk about savings and investments, basically, I will request Dr. Kumaresh to give his next presentation.
Please.
See my screen, sir?
No, you are yet to start.
Can you see me, sir, now?
Not yet. Yeah, only we can see you.
Okay, sir.
So, best is to have it on and switch it on. Yeah, correct.
Okay, sir.
Okay, yeah? We can see this.
Okay. So, now,
slides be enlarged, run it. Yeah, correct. Thank you.
Now, we define investment. What is investment? Suppose we invest in an instrument that will give return. For that return, we have got a tax. So, post-tax return of any investment should be at least 1% above inflation. We all know very well inflation is panavikam or velaivasi etram. For the past 40 years, inflation is approximately 7%. My son asked me, what is inflation? I told him, we go to grocery shop and buy 1 kg of rice. Last year, 1 kg of rice is 100 rupees. This year, we go to the same grocery shop and buy the same quality of rice, 1 kg, the cost today is 107 rupees. That is, last year 100 rupees has become 107 rupees. So, any investment after tax should be at least 1% above inflation. So, that is the definition of, we will define something, no? We have guidelines. What are all the asset class in the world? Fixed deposits are bond, gold, real estate, shares are equities. Then we will see how interest income we have got, say, we invest in savings account, fixed deposit, recurring deposit, PPF, Sukanya Samriddhi scheme, and Kisan Vagas. All the interest is fully taxable. All are having more than 10 lakhs of income, means 30% is taxed. What all the tax-free interest we will get in public provident fund, Sukanya Samriddhi scheme, or Selva Magal Snehithitam of Tamil Nadu, tax-free bonds held till maturity. Only these things, the interest income is tax-free. Rest, all are fully taxable. That is, 30% of the interest is taxed. Suppose I invest in fixed deposits. 100 rupees, I invest in fixed deposit. For the past 40 years, interest rate is approximately 8%. So interest is comes to 8 rupees. What is the tax? 2.4. From 8 rupees, I have to pay 2.4 tax. Net 5 rupees 60 paise I will have in hand. So after 1 year, I will get the principal back and post-tax return 5.6. Totally 105 rupees 60 paise I will have in my hand. If I last year 1 kg of rice is 100 rupees and this year the cost of the rice per kg is 107 rupees. But can we get the same 1 kg of rice what we got last year? No, because of taxes and inflation. So fixed deposits are not investments at all. Fixed deposits are not investment at all. Public provident fund interest is tax-free. So it is eligible, comes into eligibility as investment category. Suppose if you buy and sell gold in white, we have to pay tax. So post-tax return of gold just beats inflation. What about real estate? Real estate, generally we talk in terms of absolute terms. 40 years back, we have got a land for 3,000 rupees. Today it is selling for 3 lakh rupee. We tell it is multiplied by 100 times. But Investopedia says past 20 years return is approximately 9.5%. What are all the disadvantages of real estate? A large amount is locked, illiquid, partial sale is not possible. Cases will be there, fake documents, encumbrances, land grabbing. Dividing to legal hires is difficult. We have to pay long-term capital gains on sale. Can we buy a flat? Building is a depreciating asset and land is only appreciating. So the undivided share, even though we buy 1,500 square foot of an apartment, only 350 square foot undivided share is our land. That only appreciate. If you ask, what's the cost of this apartment? He will tell 1 crore, but we might not have taken into consideration registration charge 4 rupees, stamp paper 7%, brokerage 1-2%. That comes around 12%. So 1 crore 12 lakh rupee. That will be the cost. But we don't take into this consideration. And we have to pay property tax, drainage, maintenance tax. And if you sell, brokerage you have to be minus. And we have to pay long-term capital gains. For the past 40 years, inflation is approximately 7%. Fixed deposit has got 8%. Gold has given 9.5% return. Sensex has given 16% of return. We all know Sensex is nothing but India's topmost 30 companies like Reliance, L&T, HDFC Bank, all those things, Infosys. So it has given 16%. It doesn't look amazing, no, the returns. But if we let us say put in calculator, 100 rupees we put in fixed deposit 40 years back, 100 rupees in gold, 100 rupees in Sensex. We will see how much we have got today means, it means a lot. So I put in calculator, the principal is 100 rupees, rate of interest is 8%, 40 years means the 100 rupees today after 40 years, it has become 2100 rupees. That is 100 rupees has multiplied by 21 times. Suppose if I have invested in gold, then it might have become 37 times. 100 rupee has become 3700 rupee notes. If you have invested in Sensex 100, today the value will be 378 times it might have increased. Now, I have to clarify you, in FD, 18% means 21. In fixed, in Sensex, twice the amount, no? 18 to 16 means it should come, I have come to 42, no? How come it has multiplied by 378 times? That is because of compound interest. Einstein has told compound interest is the eighth wonder of the world. He who understands the compound interest earns it. Simple interest, we all know very well. Simple interest is equal to the principal rate of interest into time. But compound interest is formula is complex. And this is the wealth creation formula. And we don't know what Sensex has given 16% or not. Right? So, April 1st, 40 more years before 100 rupees, suppose April 40 years back, Sensex started as index as 100. So, what is the Sensex today? I asked Google today, 1st July, it is 35,400 today, today's Sensex. So, 378 means 16%. Today value, it is approximately 16% it has given. But we don't invest in shares. Why? Because the paper will tell, no, bloodbath in share market. Pangu chandai kadum sarivu. 7 lakh crore wiped it in a week. Like that, the paper will give all bad news. Newspaper is media are full of bad news. So we become afraid of all those things. Whether it has happened? Yes, it has happened. In 1992, Harshad Mehta scam, the market has fallen 50%. In 2000, dot-com bust, market has fallen 15%. In 2008, global financial crisis, market has fallen 60%. And now, in Corona, we have lost 30% in this fall. Slowly, it is regaining. In spite of that, so many 50% of fall in long term, there is growth of approximately 16%. Market has fallen. Everybody says market has fallen and wealth is wiped out. But nobody has told us wealth is created in share market because it has given 16% compounded rate, annualized growth rate, no? So that we don't get in media. We have seen market has fallen, but nobody has told how many days it took to recover. In 1992, it has taken only 473 days to recover. In 2845 days to recover. And in 2008, it took only 1.5 years to recover to the same value. Generally, we all know very well, buy low, sell high. But what we do generally, we are emotional on insurance and investments. When the share market is falling, we all take the money out and come out and will say, share market is gambling and it is waste, all those things. But wealth is created here. Have we not waited for next 1.5 to 2 years? We might have got the same money back and we might have got created wealth, no? That patience we don't have. Whether the volatility is there in share market, no? No, it is there in gold. See, gold in 2012 to 2019 June, see, same level. It has fallen actually. See, 2013 to 2015, the gold price has fallen and for 2013 to 2019, there was zero return was there in gold. From June 2019, the gold prices are going up. And we don't consider all those things. And we sell, we tell gold prices, gold will rise like anything. So sum up, if you have invested past years in fixed deposit, our wealth might have multiplied by only 21 times, gold by 37 times, and Sensex by 354 times. So this is a summary regarding investments in fixed deposits, gold, Sensex. In real estate, it has multiplied by 100 to 150 times. This is my second part of this.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kumaresh, for clarifying. So you are telling us don't put money in FD. That is not going to get you anything. If you are going to wait for a long time, perhaps gold or Sensex or even land would be a good option. Okay, before we go into the nitty-gritties of where to put money, various kinds of mutual fund, etc. Now we'll go into another thing, which is loan, debt. You know, many of us during our growth in varying periods of time would like to take a loan. Loan maybe for a two-wheeler, maybe for a car, maybe for a wedding, maybe for a house. I'll ask Dr. Vimal and to tell us how to proceed with taking a loan. Let's say somebody wants to take a loan of 5 lakhs for a car and somebody wants to take a loan of 50 lakhs for a house. So I'll ask Dr. Vimal to tell us whether it is worth taking a loan for something not exceedingly essential.
Sir, actually loan is, you should understand, you would never have the full amount of money. For example, if you want to buy a house, the house is around 1 crore. You would never have that amount of money in your hand at any point of time. For example, now I don't have 1 crore, but I need a house. So the bare minimum you should have is 30%. That is the rule of thumb. For example, if you have 30, if the house is 1 crore, if you have 30 lakhs, the bank will give you maybe 70 lakhs. So you need to calculate basically based on your own salary and what would be your growth in the next 5 to 10 years. And you need to, before approaching the bank, you need to have your idea. Like, for example, I would be earning for the next 5 years, 10 years, and improvement in my finances per year would be like 5 to 10% or whatever it may be. And what would be the average tenure that I'm going to ask? These are the three things you need to essentially determine yourself before going to the bank, because bank would tell you so many things. And they would tell you like, for example, we would give you 80%, but the 80% is not acceptable. Usually people accept 30%. So if you want to get a home loan, you need to have at least 30% initially. For that, they would ask you, for example, if you have a token advance, it's called token advance for booking a house. They would tell you like you need to pay 10 lakhs initially for booking a house. So that would be 10 lakhs. And then in a month's time or in 2 months' time, depending on the builder, they would ask you the rest of the 30%. So that would be 30 lakhs in a month or 2 months' time. So you need to have this amount of finances ready before going in for, you know, a home loan or whatever may be the kind of loan you need to purchase, you need to get. For example, 50 lakhs. Let's say for you say it's 50 lakhs. The current, maybe the loan, the interest rates are coming down rapidly now. So from 9.5% where an year ago it's come down to around 7%. It may come even down. That's the expected expected rate. It's around 6.5 to 7% now. So you need to have an idea of how much you're going to earn and what would be your yearly improvement, like maybe 10% or 5%, and then you decide the tenure. Like usually, the longer the tenure, the more you end up paying. For example, if you are applying for a loan of 1 crore, you in 15 years time you end up paying at least 1.8 crores or sometimes even 2 crores, depending upon the interest rate. So the longer the tenure, the more you're going to pay, and the shorter the tenure, the more EMI. So the gross, like they usually the rule of thumb is you calculate your salary, they calculate your salary, and the EMI should be less than 50% of your salary. You need at least 50% for you and your children and for your routine day-to-day activity. So this is how generally we need to approach the loans. So for a two-wheeler or a four-wheeler loan, I think it's not a major problem actually, because the tenure is usually around 5 years. You can make it less, and the lock-in period is around 6 months. So if for 6 months you can't pay it back, and after that you can pay with some penalty. So I feel the most important thing is like your home loan and the professional improvement you're going to make. You're going to make some, for example, you have a clinic, you need to improve your clinic to make it, you know, or you want to build a small nursing home, you need a professional loan. And these are the things you should be more careful, especially because you're going to borrow a lot of amount and you need to calculate many things. That includes mainly the EMI and also the longevity, I mean, your term, how many years you're going to do it.
Okay, Vimal, I have one question. You have calculated, say, your EMI is going to be, let's say, 18,000 rupees to 20,000 rupees a month. Supposing what happens if there's a shortfall in your earnings? One. Two, you are indisposed for a longer time. Three, something happens to you. Who will pay that much of money? What do you do for that?
Sir, there are two things. One is like when you take a bigger loan, for example, you are going to take, there are two types of loan actually. This home loan is a secured loan because they give you a loan on basis of the house, like the house they're going to build. They make an assessment on the builder. They come and see. So they have a secured loan. If you don't pay the loan, they'll take back the house. There are something called unsecured loans. Unsecured loan is a professional loan. Based on your profession, your practice, they give you a loan. For they give you up to 1 crore. Sometimes 70 lakhs, 80 lakhs. They give just like based on your IT returns and based on your practice. And these are unsecured loans. These loans, especially when you have a... So I told you two loans. So let's come to the secured loans first. So you take a loan for the house. And for some reason, you're not able to pay the EMI. Or you may have some disability so that you may not develop... You know, one may develop disability and one may even die, unfortunately. So if you don't pay it, the bank will take back the house. Your family won't have the house. And almost you, whatever term insurance that you're speaking, maybe 2 crores, 3 crores, should go to this, you know, for the normal. You don't have a house. And for that, the family would have to give this term insurance benefits to the insurance, maybe to the bank. So what they suggest is, especially when you take a bigger loan, in view of the disability, the chances of disability, death, or even, you know, inability for like this time, the corona time, you don't have the, for the next 6 months, for a year, you won't be having the same thing that you were earning the last year. So what they suggest is, especially the bigger companies like HDFC, they suggest you to take a loan insurance. This loan insurance is one time or it can be paid with the premium. So it's usually a meager amount. It's not a very big amount. It's only for the loan. It's a specific insurance only for the loan, or in case you are not able to pay the loan for some reason. And then they have the fixed prerequisites. It's not that for everybody. You can't take a loan and then say, I'm not able to pay for some reason, mainly for disability, for unemployment, or for a death. So if you're not able to pay, that loan amount is insured. So they give this amount to the bank. So this is much easier and much safer. If you take, especially when you take you're taking about 50 lakhs and 1 crore and, you know.
So this premium will be added to your EMI.
Yes, there are two options. One is one-time payment for the next 10 years, which will be a bigger amount. And that they detect usually, you know, they're very chalu. They detect from your loan amount. Or you can play it with the EMI.
Thank you.
Yeah. It's a very good question, sir.
Shivraj. Yeah. Yes, Arun.
The boss, actually, we know that one of our closest friends from Meerut, he took a house loan for 2 crores and he wrote off this insurance, saying that I don't want to pay this 50,000 as a insurance covering this loan. And right now, after a sudden demise at 40, the 1 crore is still yet to be paid and the bank is now preying upon to take upon the house. So, if though you have a term insurance with some other company, like for example, you have an insurance with SBI, if you're taking a loan from HDFC, HDFC asks for a loan for insurance for this loan from their company. Usually it's very meager. For example, for 2 crores, they've given an upfront charge of 50,000 rupees.
Okay.
50,000 when compared to 2 crores is very less. But I would suggest it better we go for it.
Thanks. Dr. Suraj, I would like to ask you, there are many people who say that investing in reality is very good. And some people probably make it a routine. They buy a house, sell it after 2 years, etc. From what I understand, it's not easy. So what is your opinion? Because most people want to have a house. Their major expense...
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Sir, yeah. The question is to me?
Yes.
Yeah, sorry, the audio is poor. I am not able to hear the
question. Okay, the question is,
just
everybody wants to have a house. There are some people who seem to be in the business of building houses and selling it or whatever. Is it really possible for somebody to make money on this without getting into so much of problems? In other words, it is advisable for somebody to have more than one house.
No.
No, actually, it is, my opinion is, house, actually, it is not advisable to have more than a house. So you, if you have rather than a house, if you, yes, you can have an additional house if you are really planning for your children or other thing. For children, for house, for children and other things. Otherwise, that is in the near term. If it is, if you are thinking that house as an investment, actually house is not a good investment.
Okay. Thank you.
You. What you are residing is.
So you need a house as an essential thing for you to live. Having more than one house is not an investment. That's what you are saying.
It is.
And would you say buying gold ornament is an investment like most ladies?
Yeah. There are.
Yeah, because there is always an issue. My wife wants to buy gold. I said, if you want to buy gold, buy it as a limited form, but not as a jewel. But she said, no, it's an investment. I need it for my daughter, etc., etc. Can you clarify on this?
Regarding buying gold, actually, you have to buy gold in all the forms. Actually, have it as gold. In which some part of it, at least 5 to 10%, you can have it as physical gold, and 15 to 20%, 10%, you can have it as ETF. Because why this 5 to 10% is? Sometimes this physical gold will be very helpful to you. It may be easily liquidated, and regarding this, and in the meantime. If, as your wife already told, they, you can actually have the pleasure of having it also. Because physical gold, the advantage of physical gold and the advantage of paper gold, ETF gold, for keeping it in locker and to safeguard it and other things. And second is, you can actually, you can trade it in the market easily, and you can liquidate it. The advantages of physical gold is you can carry it everywhere. In case, see, I had an advisor in advising a financial advisor advising about having about those refugees. Then, if many of them would have had physical gold in their hand, they did not want suffer for this one in a place where they are not used to. You can have little amount in physical gold, but rest it is better to have it as a paper gold, because paper gold is very safe. It is equally, it can be easily sold, changes and other things. You have to depend upon a jeweler or a broker, whereas ETF, it can be sold over the net.
Thank you. We are not able to hear you properly. We will come back to you later.
And for one more thing is,
thank you.
Put all the
many years ago, I was told by an insurance agent, you buy this insurance for 20 years. After every 5 years, you will get some money back, lump sum, etc., etc. And I paid religiously, and every 5 years, I used to get some money. And he said it is some kind of a cash back or some money back policy. But later, much later, I realized the money I got back was much less than what I paid. So I would like Dr. Kumaresh to talk to us about various forms of insurance and which is the best form of insurance. Dr. Kumaresh.
Yes, sir. I'm resuming my slides. Can you see our slides, sir?
Not yet.
Okay. Yeah, now we can see, sir.
No, not yet.
Not yet.
No, not yet. Okay, you can start talking, maybe.
Okay, sir. Your screen sharing is paused. It's telling why.
You choose the desktop one. That I think works better.
If the Wi-Fi is weak, no, it will take a while for the slides to come up.
Okay, sir. So mainly there are three types of life insurances. One is endowment policy, and money back policy is also a type of endowment policy. And second type is unit link insurance policies, and third is term insurance, term life insurance policy. And these are all three types of insurance policies. Your screen sharing is passed away. Okay. And I don't know why the slide is not shared.
You can go out and come back again, sir.
Okay, sir. I will go out.
Out of the slide sharing and come back.
Okay. I will stop share.
Hmm.
Then I start sharing.
Yeah.
It serves
ratio. Okay, sir. I can just continue talking till the slides come on.
No, I don't know why it has your screen sharing is paused. It's telling.
Okay. Maybe you can just shut down and join the meeting.
Yeah. You close, I'll run it from my computer.
Yeah. Sure, sir. Because third slide set of slides are there now.
No, you got to switch off. Dr. Okay. Kumaresh, unless you switch off, I can't share.
Okay. I will stop sharing. I have stopped sharing.
Yeah.
Okay, it's gone.
Okay. Yeah, these are all the three types of term insurance. Yeah. Next slide, please. I have seen so many doctors have taken this type of endowment policies. Generally, the sum assured is 10 lakh rupees and premium paid per annum is 50,000 rupees and premium paying term is 20 years. Money we will get after 20 years is 20 lakhs. So, 50 years, 50,000 we are paying for next 20 years means we are paying 10 lakhs. If in between something happens means we will get sum assured of 10 lakhs plus bonus. So if nothing happens, then money we will get after 20 years is 20 lakhs. So we think that it's very good. If you are on something happens plus, then 10 lakhs plus bonus. And nothing happens, you will get double the amount. So we think it's very good. So we have put in special financial calculator. See, payment is 50,000 rupees. In future, 20 lakhs you will get after 20 years means the rate is only 6%, which is very much less than fixed deposit price. Next slide, please, sir. Then we will go to ULIPs. In ULIPs, there are two types of ULIPs. One is invested in share market and another one invested in bonds or fixed income related. Next slide, please. All these are my personal investments and insurance. See, this is my investment in 2006. Date of commencement is 2006. I have invested 1,01,000 rupees. The policy is still in force. Till 2006, I am financially illiterate. Then I got a very good financial advisor. He asked me to stop the policy. But this policy is taken from my close friend. He told me that in long term, it will be beneficial to me. So I've kept the policy for next 13 years. And it is, see in down, you can see, it is invested in bonds. It is the investment insurance advisor has advised me that I will get 8% assured return. But after 13 years, what is the policy? See, right hand side round fund value today is 85,000 rupees after 13 years of 1 lakh rupee investment. The insurance advisor has told me 8% assured returns, but what is the return today? 85,000 rupees. I asked my insurance advisor, why it is less? He told me that you have insured, no, they will be taking charges. Next slide, please, sir. So this is my another insurance taken for in 2005 with annual premium of 25,000 rupees. I have paid 3. So total premium paid is 75,000 rupees. It is invested in shares. What is the insurance cover? 2.5 lakhs. What is the current value? In 2016, it was 1.25 lakhs. It is better, no? Investing in shares. Because in bonds, after 13 years, I got negative returns. But here, it is positive. But we have to see the compound annualized growth rate. Invested value is 75,000 rupees. Maturity after 20 years, 1.25 means rate of return is only 5% which is invested in shares. So what is the lesson that I have learned? What is the mistake that I have done? I did a postmortem of this policy. Next slide, please. There are so many charges. Premium allocation charges, monthly administrative charges, fund management charges, fixed charges, redemption charges, annual charges, so many charges are there. So that is why my fund has not raised. Next slide, please, sir. So this is my policy. I invested 25,000 rupees, but only the amount invested, I got totally 3 years, I invested, I got 2,000 units. But in 2016, see the downs there, 1,123 units were there. So all these charges, loss of unit is 878 units. It is lost because of all these charges. Next slide, please, sir. So you can see the opening balance, that is the 1,123 units are there. The total amount loss of, next slide, please, sir. See, the loss of units because of charges is 878 units. Mortality charges. That is the charges that is taken from this policy for 2.5 lakhs insuring me for a year. How much the charge is? 1,662 rupees for 2.5 lakhs. So, 665 rupees per lakh per annum, and it will be slowly increasing. If I am alive for next 1 year, for then these charges will not be given back to me because it is mortality charges. For insuring me for 1 lakh, they are charging me 665 rupees. Next slide, please, sir. See, this mortality charges is there now in between in 18th May. Next, which according to accident benefit mortality charges, you can see 1,662 rupees in this because I could not mark it because my arrow is not coming. No, please go through this. And they are charging 1,662 rupees for insuring me for 2.5 lakhs. The advisor has told me our fund has increased from, see, the NAV 24 rupees, the second NAV 24 rupees 90 paise. No, the 2005, you know. Next slide, please. It has gone from 25 to 119. 5 times it has increased. I told him NAV has raised from 25 rupees to 120 rupees. Yes, but because of loss of units, my investment of 75,000 rupees has not become 2.25 lakhs 5 times, but it is only 1.25 lakhs. And it has given only 5% returns. So what's the mistake that I have done is, I have mixed insurance with investment. So we have to separate insurance with investment. We have got a beautiful tool that is known as term insurance. Next slide, please, sir. Term insurance is cheapest. The mortality rate is 100 to 200 rupees per lakh per annum. Next slide, please, sir. And this is my term insurance. I have taken at the age of 43. I should take life insurance for 2 crores for next 20 years. So, see, below my name of the proposer, policy term is 20 years because I should take life insurance for next 20 years because my new life value is 20 years. So, I take that for 20 years. sum assured, next line, sir. Sum assured, how much I have to take? 2 crores. I have taken 2 crore rupees of this thing. Apart from that, see, let's say for this thing, I expect benefit charges of 2 crores. Totally, I have insured for 4 crores. Totally, I have insured for 4 crores because as it is, and at the change, I will be traveling here and there. So, I have insured myself for 4 crores. What is the premium? I do not have a GST, a transfer party, ₹48,000 for 400 lakhs means only ₹120 per lakh per annum. So, ₹120 per lakh per annum. In ULIP, I was paying 668 rupees per lakh per annum. But here, I am paying only ₹120 per lakh per annum. 48,000 per annum appears to be higher side, but if you divide it into monthly 12, only 4,000 rupees per month. So for life insurance, if I keep aside 4,000 rupees, peace of mind is guaranteed. If you keep aside 3,000 rupees for medical line, peace of mind is guaranteed. And this is all the types of life insurance. Thank you, sir.
So thank you, Dr. Kumaresh. Varun, you are an expert and you are an MDRT member.
Yes,
can you just tell people, if somebody has a policy,
yes,
money back or endowment policy, which is 3 years old, 4 years old, could you just sell it, stop it, accept the loss?
They already have it, sir. Okay. If the premium payment term is over, you can actually take it out, sir. But going for a term insurance at this age, for example, if a 50 plus person is going for a term insurance, right now, sir has taken an insurance for 2 crores plus accidental cover of 2 crores at 42,000 rupees. That was the rate 3 to 4 years back. But right now, all the insurance rate has hiked up because of this corona. Right now, you will have to pay anywhere between, easily between 60 to 70,000 rupees. So if you are ready to pay this term insurance for as a separate policy is better. But if you already have a policy, if your payment term is over and if your money is actually better off, I mean, you have, if, as sir, sorry, the unit, if your units are actually going in a good price, you can come out of the policy. What sir has done in any, all the mistakes, he has done a postmortem. But the problem with this is, if you plant a small plant and then say that don't water it, you don't go see it, then after 5 years come and say, oh God, the gardener said that this will give me a big tree, but it has grown only till a shrub. That is the problem. If you don't manage our funds, whether you put the plant in red soil or in black soil, if you don't daily manage your funds, there's no point of expecting any returns. So the proper fund switches has to be done. And as sir said in ULIPs, right now, fund switches has been, the charges has been waived off. Mutual funds have fund switches. So the basic idea is, if you don't manage your fund, you will not get your return. I will give an example. I took a 75,000 ULIP. I paid for 5 years. That is, I paid almost 3.5 lakh rupees. Once the policy was over, I've already taken out 5 lakhs and still I have 3 lakhs inside. I paid 3 lakhs. So the compounded annual growth rate was minimum 14%. And what I would advise you is, any doctor, you go as the financial consultant. As in, you just have to write in 1 hour online exam. You become an IRDA certified financial consultant. We'll help you with that. You invest in your name. So you get all the commission back. So with the commission added, it will come to around 16 to 17%. And mutual fund is taxable. And from today onwards, 1st July, mutual funds has to be taken with stamp duty. So they say mutual fund is sahi hai, mutual fund sahi hai. They want all your money in their economy. But the truth is that with the mutual fund, you're going to end up, whatever be the returns, even if it gets 21%, with all the taxes and gone, you'll be coming around 16 to 17% at the highest rate. But I think if you manage your fund with any ULIPs also, if you become your financial consultant for yourself, that's what I suggest. Because if there's a good customer, I'll ask them, but please don't invest with me. You become the financial consultant, you invest in yourself. it is not actually, if we can do big surgeries, laparotomies, laparoscopy, this is actually not rocket science. And only when you invest, when you put your foot down, you will learn. Not because of this 1 hour session, anything, this is just an inspiration. But what you, if you really want to learn this, you need to go through this.
You are tempting me around.
Yes, sir. Sir, please do. See, I joined critical care, sir. The first day I joined, I become a superstar anesthetist in my PG days. Go to the critical care. First day, they say, you had a gram positive coverage for this patient. I have shit no idea what gram positive coverage was at the time. So that insulted my ego. I said, how can I not know? So I stayed in critical care. They say, you go to critical care, after 6 months, they will take you to the main OT. But no, my life was finished there. So I had to learn there. So once I be there, I said that if you're going to be in ICU, let's learn. So similarly, when I invested money, then they said that you invest this, sir, we'll give you that. I said, I don't have any idea what you're talking. I want to learn this. That is the reason how we should learn it. And if you manage your funds properly, that is, if you have to change between debt funds, that is like infrastructure bonds or those kinds, which is fixed, and to share in equity or opportunity funds. So if you change your, manage your funds properly, you will definitely hit jackpot in any fund.
Okay. Thank you. And now yes, you raise the issue that mutual funds are really not that good. And let's see, everybody is thinking that, see, FD is not good. You can't buy gold. You can't buy a house. Then where do you keep the money? Keep it in your bank. Probably it is not enough. Anyway, I'll ask Dr. Kumaresh to say, if you have money and if you can invest it, how best to invest? Dr. Kumaresh, please.
Yeah. We stopped. We have seen fixed deposit is not an investment at all.
Are you able to see the slide?
No, I cannot resume. Why I can't go?
Sir, slides are not yet up. Not yet up. I think Kumaresh has to stop the screen sharing and Bhaskar sir better.
Kumaresh, please stop.
One minute. I will try again and then if not possible, because I am disturbing you, no? Sorry, sir. You can please. I will stop sharing. Please use proceed next, sir. Yeah. Yeah, we talked about fixed deposits and gold, real estate, and then investing in Sensex. Sensex, can you buy shares? Yes, I tried between 2003 and 2008. If you want to invest in shares, we have to see the business cycle. We have to see the vision, mission, price to earning ratio, price to book ratio, return of capital employed, and I have to read the balance sheet. And all those things I tried for next 5 years. I have read fundamental analysis. I have done. It has come, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. Then I also done the technical analysis part. All the star charting, then mean average conversion diversions, and maps. All those things I have tried. Bollinger chart I have tried, but my advisor told me that without reading the shares, that 300 pages of share for shareholders they will send, you have to read, analyze, and then you must send the report. Then only you should buy the shares. Then I started investing according to that. But my mutual fund manager has given 3 to 4 percentage points more than me. So I closed my demat account and started investing in mutual funds alone. Then comes mutual fund are subjected to market risk. Mutual fund are subject to market risk. We are taking so many risks for taking a patient. See, as a renal transplant cases, all sort of complication, anemia, hypertension, ischemic heart disease, cardiac failure, disc electrolytes, and urea creatinine elevated, anemia, all with all sort of complications. I could take cases because I have read, I have got experience in renal transplant anesthesia. When he explained all those sorts of complications like CCF, patient agree. Like that, mutual funds are subject to the market risk. Is informed consent for surgery and anesthesia. And we should know that there is no risk-free investment in the world. The only way we should know is how to tide over the risk. The only way to tide over the risk is give time. This is the slide it is showing. Just simply, we wait for next 1.5 to 2 years, we might have got the same money back. Then we should have patience. That's the only mantra here while investing in. Next slide, please. The advantages of mutual fund are professional management, liquidity. There is no lock-in period, nothing like that. Today you can go, tomorrow you can come out. You can get money within four working days. You can get. It is low cost. Only the maximum charges allowed is 2.5%, inclusive of all charges. In ULIP, we have seen 9-10 charges are there, but here only one charge. Only one charge is there. That is total expense ratio, inclusive of all charges. You split up so many charges and they will come out with fund management charges. No, it's not right. And it's transparent in units of insurance policies, portfolio, and all those things. Nowadays, it's not true at all. And it's really by the and we can diversify our portfolio. Next slide, please. What are the types of mutual funds? We think that mutual funds means investing in shares. No, we have got investing in shares. We have got investing in bonds. And hybrid is a mixture of equity and debt mutual funds. My son asked me, what is equity? I want to start a company. I speak with, but I want one company. And the master is my friend. So, we both become partners.
We can't hear you, Dr. Kumaresh.
That is share market. And another person. Hello? Now it's okay?
Yeah.
Okay. And Dr. Varun sir is another friend. He has got 1 crore. And we are getting loan. Irrespective we make profit or loss, we will give interest because we have got loan from Dr. Varun sir. So that is debt. This is debt market. And equity is sharing of profit or loss. And in that company, we have got equal rights. That is equity mutual fund. If you get loan, that is debt mutual fund. Hybrid is a mixture of equity and debt mutual funds. Next slide, please. And these are all some of my investments in mutual funds. See, for the past 1 year, I'm investing approximately 1.5 lakhs per month. I am investing in this. Totally, I invested 18 lakh rupees. Because of this market down, the value today I lost is approximately 79,000 rupees. Next slide, please. Because the market is in short term, the market because of volatility has come down. See, 2,366 days, the 1 lakh rupee I invested, the value today after this fall is 3 lakh rupees. So what's the appreciation? 2 lakh rupees. In long term, see the value, how much it appreciates. Next slide, please. This is another investment in HDFC mutual fund. 60,000 rupees invested, and this comes to approximately tripling in for the past 6 to 7 years. Next slide, please. Can you, next slide, please. See, this was invested in 2006. 2006, I invested in this. In 2010, because of this market fall, it has gone to 4.2 lakh rupees. In 2020, what could be the value? Next slide, please. I asked Google, the value today is 42 rupees. Next slide, please. Suppose I invested 10 lakh rupees. Next slide, please, sir. 10 lakh rupees in 2010, because of this market fall, it is 4.2 lakh. In 2020, it has become 10 times. Generally, we should buy when the market is low. You can tell in 2002 to 2020, only 4.2 times return. But if you have invested in 2010, we might have multiplied our wealth by 10 times. 10 lakh rupees, if I invested in 2010, today the value is 1 crore rupees. So buy low, sell high concept, we will tell. But generally, we could not follow because nobody in the world could follow because nobody can buy, predict which is low and which is high. Next slide, please. That's why I am still every month I am investing 1.5 lakh rupees in the same fund because I am buying low. After 4 or 5 years, I can get very good returns because generally we buy our dresses during festivals, anniversaries. Next is 50% Aadri Talubadi. I am buying in this Aadri Talubadi. We have to see the taxation aspect in short term. That is, if you buy equity less than 1 year, equity share, if it is there in less than 1 year, 50% gain will be taxed. The entire amount that we get is was entirely tax-free. So we have built a 5 crore worth hospital without debt. I was investing since 2003, 4, 5, 6 in mutual funds. My auditor was against it. Don't go into all those things. But 2012 to 2016, we took money from the hospital and built our hospital without debt because of mutual fund investments. From 2018, the long-term capital gain is
1%. Kumaresh, you need to adjust your mic. We can't hear you properly.
Now, sir?
Now it's fine.
I think Sarah's muted himself.
No, it's gone off again. No, it's gone off.
Sarah's muted himself.
Hello.
Now it's clear.
We can't get.
Okay.
Yeah. And now it's okay. Yeah.
Long-term capital gain more than 30 years means 20% after indexation. We will see it one by one. Next slide, please. As an alternative to fixed deposits, we can invest in debt mutual funds. It is tax efficient, no TDS. We can withdraw it anytime. Next slide, please. Tisra, where do they LIC invest? Or ULIP invest, that will be invested in government bonds, corporate bonds, treasury bills, commercial bills, and commercial papers. And in these instruments only, the debt mutual funds are investing. If you strongly believe in LIC, then we can invest in debt mutual funds also. See, for the past 470 days, the investment is approximately 6.5 to 7%. Next slide, please, sir. See, 6.77%. Next slide, please, sir. Next slide, please. This is cost inflation index, which is issued by Central Board of Direct Taxes by Income Tax Department of India every year, June end. What is this inflation means? There are certain essential 400 basket of 400 essential commodities. If we have got this particular quantity in 2001 for 100 rupees, to buy the same thing in 2017-18, the cost is 278 rupees. That's what is in place. Let us see how can we put into it use. Next slide, please, sir. Tax savings. Suppose we have invested in fixed deposit, 1 lakh rupees, 3 years, 8% means we will get 1 lakh 25,000 rupees. For 25,971, we have to pay a tax of 30%. 8,500 rupees, we need to pay tax if you take out after 3 years. In debt mutual fund, if we get 8%, 1 lakh 25,000 rupees, same thing will come. But if you apply indexation, 3 years back, the index was 240. Today is 275. So 240 has become 275. That means 1 lakh rupee has become, because of inflation, to buy the same quantity of that particular essential commodity, we need to have 1 lakh 13,000 rupees, 333. So we have to less this inflation cost from your 1.25 lakhs. So our total gain is only 12,000 rupees. What is the tax? Next slide, please. After tax, debt mutual fund, long-term capital gain after 3 lakhs, 20% after indexation. We have seen the gain of, next slide, please. 12,000 rupees, 638 gains. What is the tax on 20%? 2,500 rupees only. So we are saving tax of 6,500 rupees. And this is tax efficient, not tax evasion. We are not evading any tax. This is tax efficient. We will see it. What happens in 4 years. Next slide, please, sir. See, 4 years back, 220, the cost inflation index is. Today is 275. Next slide, please. If you put the same calculation, savings in tax alone has become 8,332 rupees. This is cost inflation. Next slide, please. So it's a particular scenario that we have invested in March 2014 and taken out after 37 months. Because it has become 4 financial years, we have to do 4-year indexation. So the tax will become 611 rupees only. Savings in tax alone, 7,900 rupees. See the tax difference between debt mutual fund. This is the advantage of debt mutual fund investment. Next slide, please. So in my experience, which doesn't beat inflation, is fixed deposit 5.6%. Endowment life policy has given only 5.6%. My ULIP invested bonds has given negative returns. My investment in shares has given only 5%. Next slide, please. Then which beats inflation is gold just beats inflation, and real estate, it has given 9-10% of returns, and Sensex has given 16% of returns. And that's what that's my end of this part of.
Thank you, Dr. Kumaresh. So you are a great favor. You favor strongly mutual funds. Are anything that is
bank linked share, sir.
And instead of FD, you would recommend people should put it in debt funds. So that might be clear. Instead of FD, you put it in debt funds.
Yes,
even if the interest rate is the same, because of the indexation, you get advantage.
That and advantage.
For a long time, put it in some equity fund. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Your point is well taken. Dr. Vimal, now if you had invested money now, and in this fall, it would have gone to 20-30%. And if you have remained without a heart attack, that means you have a lion's heart. So probably investing in equity directly is not for timid people. What do you say?
Sir, basically, for example, everybody has a risk appetite. That's the right word, I think. Varun will also agree.
Yes, sir.
For example, if you want to play it safe, I would say you stick to mutual funds. And instead of FD, like Dr. Kumaresh said, you should, if instead of FD, you put it on a debt mutual fund where you have a fixed confirmed return, which would be tax free. And if you are really having a good risk, because the in share market, the problem is the more the risk, the better would be the return. And exactly the same thing, if the more the risk, the more you lose the capital. For example, if you're investing 20 lakhs, after 3 years, your capital would depreciate to 16 lakhs if you have taken more risk. So generally what the policy is like, you need to diversify your risk. Like for example, you need to diversify your sectors. Like you should not be, for example, if you want to invest only in information technology, for IT, for example, you want to take only in, for example, you want to take Infosys or TCS, which are better companies. So if you want to invest only in them, then you invest in them, but your return could be average around 10-15% over 3 or 4 years. But if you take like smaller companies, like there are three things. I think for to be made, to make it clear, there are three kinds of shares that generally the one are something is called blue chip shares, where the company valuation is very high, and these are standard companies. They have they have stood the test of time. These are blue chip companies. And for then next would be the mid cap companies, which are like somewhere close to becoming a blue chip company, and then another one is a small cap. The small cap is the higher risk companies. They're like where they, for example, the shares would be somewhere around 30 rupees or 40 rupees, and in 10 years time or 5 years time, they promise you a growth of like 100 times. Like it would be somewhere around 400 or sometimes even 4000. But sometimes in 5 years time or 10 years time, the company would be nowhere. Like you would be selling for 4 rupees or 40 paise, and even sometimes the company would be closed. So that is the risk you take when you invest in small cap, like, or smaller companies, where the risk is more, the benefit is, like, for example, if you bet on them, you think it is okay. But for us as VC surgeons or even surgeons, so like, it's better not to go for small cap companies. I would suggest you to stick to blue chip and some mid cap companies. That's where the financial advisors like Varun or Dr. Jagdish come in, Satish come in. It's very important to have some financial advice. Otherwise, you tend to lose money, especially in these times. Generally, you invest like 30 lakhs of hard-earned money, and in 5 years you see it's come down to 26 lakhs. Then your mother would say like, "What do you? Bachcha, iske liye bank hai. You have bank. Why do you want to take such risks?" So this is the most important thing. If you're going to invest more, I think you should have some financial advisor who have understood the risks and benefits of investing in equity. Otherwise, I feel the best thing would to stick to, mutual funds, some equity mutual funds and debt funds. That would be my advice. After these 5 years of investing, I have learned only that.
Thank you. Yeah. Dr. Khanna is here. He joined late.
I joined at the beginning, but I could not from my laptop connect, sir.
Okay.
So now you can hear me?
We can hear you. We can see you also.
I won't be able to share any slides with you. All the topics that have been covered, I want to make a few points on those. One is the loans. We were talking of home loans. Home loans are the good loans. So the good loans should be taken. But the other loans are the bad loans, the vehicle loans, the gadget loans, the short-term loans of things that you buy, and they, for example, you buy a vehicle, and the moment you drive it out of the agency, it is down by 25-40%. So those are not good loans, but one is a good loan to have because it gives you tax too. The second thing which was brought up was on home insurance. The loan should be insured, but the loan insurance will not cover loss of income, temporary loss of income like these days. That you will have to make up from your other savings. Only if you lose your life, it is a kind of a life insurance for the home loan. So that should definitely be taken, so that in case you lose your life, at least your dependents don't have to also pay off your home loan. A couple of points. The third was gold. The best way to buy gold today is the gold bonds which are being issued by the Government of India from time to time. That's the best way. They also give you a 2.5% interest on the gold, plus the appreciation of the gold is given. The second best way is to buy gold exchange traded funds, which are available on, they are just like mutual funds which you can purchase on the market. Physical gold is not a good thing to buy. Physical gold is not, you have to keep it safe, you have to put it in a locker, you have to lose sleep over it. That's not a good thing to buy.
And you also pay tax on that. You also pay tax on that when you buy physical gold compared to ETF.
Yeah, the ETF is also taxable. ETF is also taxable, but the tax rates are much, much lower. On physical gold, the taxes are higher. The best thing, like I said, is the gold bonds, which are giving you an interest on your holding of gold. And after 5 years or 7 years, when you sell the bonds, you get the market rate of gold at that time. So that is the best way to keep gold, not physical gold.
And you can give your gold bonds to the companies like Muthoot. You can go and keep your physical gold bonds like you keep your physical gold.
So that is the best way to keep gold, because your gold, instead of just lying and giving you tension, is also earning you some income. 2.5% also in these days is pretty good when interest rates on a savings accounts are down to 3 and 3.5%. Then, as sir correctly said, do not confuse and combine insurance with investment. That is one of the things. Term insurance is separate, and your investment is totally separate. All of us posted in Command Hospital in Pune were sold these policies, these endowment policies. कि एक बार आप 5 लाख का 10 लाख का पॉलिसी ले लो और आपका लाइफ बन गया. So we are all paying those. But on endowment policies, what I would like to say is that if you are at the beginning, in the first 4 to 5 years of an endowment policy, then you can be brutal with it and just cut it out like a tumor. But if you are reaching towards the end of the policy, you have already paid most of the premiums, last 3-4 years to go, then just continue and live with it. Once you're nearing the end of the policy, there is no point in discontinuing it when only 2-3 premiums are left to pay, which is the case with most of us. Then investing in shares and mutual funds is not something on a 5-year time frame. You have to go minimum 7 to 10 years or longer. In fact, there was a study in the US which said that the best investor is the dead investor. The guy who has not touched his shares for the last 30 years because he died is the guy who's getting the best returns. So that is, I mean, you have to obviously look at your investments, but the longer you stay, like Warren Buffett likes to say, instead of timing the market, time in the market is what is important. So you have to stay for long to reap rewards. These are just the points which were covered, which I am talking of. The best returns that I have individually, and I know people who have earned, is from buying shares directly. There is nothing to beat the kind of returns that you can have if you keep them over the long term. But it is better to stick to mutual funds. If your knowledge is limited, if you don't have the time, like most of us don't have, it's better to stick to mutual funds. One very important question is, if you're investing in shares, how many shares? So the best combination that my sort of 25 odd years of investing acumen have given me is that it should be between a figure between 10 to 20. Don't go above. Don't over diversify into shares or invest just 1 lakh rupees in 50 companies. Invest a solid amount into a solid company. If you want to invest and you say, mujhe itna research nahi karna, to just look at, for example, you want to invest in a sector, say banks. You want to invest in banks? So you look at which is the best bank or the best 1 and 2 in banks. And put your money in a, say, a HDFC bank, which is the best housing finance company. So if you say HDFC or a LIC housing finance, maybe, I mean, if you want to go directly into shares, otherwise, if you don't have the knowledge or the time, you go through mutual funds. The how many funds to buy? That's a huge question, because the ratings of funds keep changing in the various advisories, the Money Control and the Value Research Online. These are the two sites I want all people to write down. One is valueresearchonline.com and one is Money Control. You can get a lot of knowledge on investing through these two. In fact, the Value Research Online is run by a very down-to-earth fellow called Dhirinder Kumar, who gives you very practical and down-to-earth advice. So the basic advice is you should not have more than 3 to 5 funds. The total number of mutual funds that you hold should be between 3 to 5, of which in at our age, probably one should be a large cap fund, 2 multi-cap funds, and 1 hybrid fund. Plus, the debt fund investing has become very, very dicey these days. The safest debt fund today are the liquid funds, which are giving you enough of return with maximum safety and liquidity, in that you can encash them the next day. So you can, if you withdraw money from a liquid fund, the next day you can withdraw it. One very important point which has not been covered throughout this is having an emergency fund. One of the first things that you do after insurance, after you got your insurance in place, is to have a contingency fund, which is an emergency fund, which should be at between, in these corona times, between 6 to 12 months of your income. So that much money should either be in an FD in the bank, in your savings account, even if it is not earning enough interest, or in a liquid fund. So at least these 12 months, 6 to 12 months should be in an emergency contingency fund. The other points that I wanted to say was, we should start investing early. Be very consistent with investments. Thirdly, we should automate investing, because we don't have the time. For example, today we were from 9 o'clock till 4 o'clock busy in the OT. The entire time of the market is gone in that. So you can't really keep track of the market. The best is to automate it, put it in SIPs. You don't have to worry about the ups and downs. Over a period of 15, 20, 30 years of investing, it gets evened out and you get fantastic returns. I can tell you, because I have earned some of those. Another thing we should do is save first, spend later. So if we automate the SIPs between the 1st and 7th of the month, मेरे तीन चार पांच फंड्स में पैसा चला जाएगा, तो जो बाकी जो बचेगा, दैट इज व्हाट आई यूज फॉर माय स्पेंडिंग. सो दीज आर द पॉइंट्स आई वांटेड टू कवर.
थैंक यू राजेश, थैंक यू वेरी मच. सॉरी वी कुड हैव यू अर्लियर बिकॉज़ वी डिडंट नो यू आर अराउंड. एनीवे गुड, यू केम आउट. नाउ वी हैव टू पीपल हु आर फाइनेंशियल प्लानर्स. आई रिमेंबर व्हेन आई टुक प्रीमैच्योर रिटायरमेंट, some bank people came, studied my family, and they gave me a presentation for 20 minutes as to what I should do with my money and what all I should do. So I would now request Dr. Kumaresh to tell what is financial planning and how it is going to help you. Kumaresh, can you start the...
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Slides are coming, sir? If not, please, you please, sir.
Are the slides there? Can you see?
No. Please, you please, sir. Sorry, sir.
No problem.
So, with my limited knowledge, I could not study all the shares. So, I stick into mutual funds. So, what I do is financial planning. Because Warren Buffett says, an idiot with a plan can beat a genius without plan.
Just hold on.
Bhaskaran, we are running out of time. We have 10 more minutes. Bhaskaran?
Yes, please. Dr. Kumaresh?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Next slide, please. We can run, sir. Okay, no problem. Can go fast. Next slide, please, sir. Next slide, please, sir. So, I will write a case sheet like this for all my clients. Name, date of birth, the income, spouse income, income from other sources like agriculture income, rental income, expenses, then will be saving, income minus expenses saving, what are all the loans they have got, what are all the insurance they have got, whether they have got PPF or not. PPF is the main major tool, because PPF gives interest free income. And we have to see the risk.
We can't hear you. Kumaresh, I think we can't hear you.
Hello?
Varun, will you take over?
Sir, actually, we are running out of short of time. So what better is, we can just summarize the whole evening.
Okay.
As you told, sir, the priority, we should start early for both term insurance and for investment. And once you are, I will give you three rules of thumb, sir. One is, you should know what your goal is. In financial planning, the simple thing is, you should know what your goal is. For example, when my child is about to be married, I want to throw a lavish wedding. I need 2 crores for that. That's a goal. When my child goes for 17 years, I need to get her into a medical college. It might cost 50 lakhs to 1 crore. That's a goal. I need to retire. And the retirement, I need to have a monthly income of 3 lakhs. That's a goal. So you should know what your goal is. That's the first point. 2, how much am I comfortable to invest? Like to run around my basic necessities for groceries, everything, rent, or a home, EMIs. After that, how much am I comfortable with? Once I know how much I am comfortable with, we should know how much risk I am ready to take. You should take more risk when you are younger. It can, like in the rule of thumb, you can go for 100 minus age. If you are 30, you can go 70% risk and 30% into debt funds. And when you age more and more, you don't go into risk taking funds. You go into more of debt funds, less and less of share market funds or equity funds, what you call this. So we should know what the goal is, and you should know how much I am ready to afford. And we should always have a plan, as Sir has said. There should be a diversification. You should not put all your money into shares, all your money into ULIPs, all your money into MFs, or only into gold. So don't put all your eggs in one basket. And as another Sir rightly mentioned, you first start paying yourself. You pay your gardener, you pay your maid. So what is paying yourself? It is the savings. So as a rule of thumb, 30% should go into savings. And you should have at 30% to ready for investment. And how much risk you're going to take in the investment depends on you. Physical gold, one more point to be added is, whatever gold my mother or my mother-in-law has bought, my child is not going to wear it. I'm going to say, erase all that gold, make it into new gold, new chains for my marriage. So you're going to lose when you bought it for making charges, then for reselling it, then buying again another making charges. So better go for gold bonds. I think with that, we can call it a day, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. So overall, with all the panelists, I may take the opportunity to conclude that financial management involves, first, everybody should take care of the insurance. Health insurance if required, definitely health insurance and professional insurance. After that, as Colonel Rajesh said, we should have an emergency contingency fund, which would be equivalent to about 6 months to 12 months of your earning, which is for any buffer for any emergency. So that should be easily available. It should not be invested in something which is very difficult to retrieve. And after that, whatever money you get, you should be able to save about 30%. Maybe it may not be possible to save 30% in the initial ages, but later you should be able to do it. And that should be invested wisely in a systematic manner, so that you are able to beat the inflation and your money is going to compound on its own. And above all, there is something which we were not at time to discuss. Everybody should write a bill. A bill should be written at every age. The moment you start earning, there should be a bill to inherit it. Whenever you have some money, it must be a bill, so that there is no confusion, there is no problem after that. I think with this, we'll wind up the session. And I thank all the panelists for their wonderful contribution and improving, at least my knowledge has improved. Thank you very much. And I'm sorry.
Bhaskaran, my only request is, I think this is a very vast topic. We should have one more session with the same speakers, please, because there's so many people with so many questions, and you know, none of them are able to answer. We'll continue in the next session if the panelists are okay with it.
Yeah, I'll talk to them. And yeah, maybe we should also include the what is referred to as estate planning, succession planning, that is about will, which is the important component.
My request to the eminent panelists is to be there again coming Wednesday so we can continue on this.
Yeah, I'll talk to them.
Right, okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for having us, sir. Good evening, everybody. We'll meet again then. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Suraj, can you hear us? There is always some audio problem from your side.
We need to check it out, yes.
Yeah. Thank you.